The following production is part of the Play Some Video Games Podcast Network.
Coverage for games you play on your table and on your television. You can think of us as the Colt and Tum Tum of gaming podcasts. We're a proud member of the PSVG Podcast Network and now a member of the Make Us Better team over on Patreon. I'm one of your hosts, Kyle, and joining me on this co-op adventure, the guy whose gaming prowess is only surpassed by his ninja skills. Josh, how are you doing this evening?
I'm great. You know, I was very happy to read your intro, knowing all I know about three ninjas. But I don't want to know which one I am. So let's not get into if I'm Colt or Tum Tum.
Okay.
Because I think I'll be sad if I find out.
I mean, I have ideas in my head about which one you are, but we want to talk about those right now.
Yeah. Other than that, I'm sweaty and flooded and tired as usual. So
as is par for the course. But hey, if you're not someone who understands this reference, you might not realize that there's one person missing from this reference. While two ninjas are awesome, three ninjas are better. And with that, we welcome the Rocky of this trio to the podcast, Callin Flores from Plaid Hat Games. Callin, welcome, sir. We're so happy to have you.
Thank you for having me.
So, Callin, you know, our listeners know who Josh and I are and hear us ramble about games all the time. But why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, for sure. My name is Callin Flores. I'm the communications manager for Plaid Hat Games. And if you haven't heard of Plaid Hat Games, it's a board game design studio. We've made titles such as Dead of Winter, Stuffed Fables, Ashes, Summoner Wars. We've got a whole back catalog where we strive to do head-to-head dueling card games, thematic games, and pretty much just anything that's fresh and exciting. That's definitely what we want to, you know, assign our brand to.
Awesome. Well, hey, we're really excited to have you on the show tonight, and there's a very special reason that we do, and we're going to get to that a little bit later on.
Besides my love of Three Ninjas.
Do you actually love Three Ninjas?
I remember watching a lot of the VHS as a kid. That being said, I did not recognize any of the names when they came out, so I guess I don't love Three Ninjas as much as I thought I did.
Yeah, I'll be honest, like when I come up with the duos for doing the intro to the podcast, it's not that hard, but coming up with trios that are recognizable is a little more challenging.
And
Three Ninjas is one of the few movies as a kid I saw in the theaters. So it talks a little bit about how old I am, but also about how sad my movie going choices were back then. But anyway, hey, thanks so much for joining us this week. It's not a movie podcast. We are a gaming podcast. So as always, if you have any feedback, questions, suggested topics, hit us up at Bored with VG on Twitter or over on Instagram, also Bored with VG, to see all the awesome pictures of the games that Josh is posting over there. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/boardwithvg. And if you want to give us that long form email, still waiting for that first fan fiction, boardwithvg@gmail.com. As always, use that hashtag boardwithvg on all of the social media so we know what you're talking about. And if you're so inclined, feel free to check out the Make Us Better Patreon at patreon.com/makeusbetter. We really appreciate all the folks who chip us a few bucks over there so we can continue doing all the awesome things with you. So enough of this housekeeping. Callin, since you are our guest, you get to go first. What games have you been playing on your tabletop, sir?
I've actually been playing a lot of games lately. I moved in with my long-term girlfriend a couple months back, and ever since then, she's just been kind of introducing herself to the hobby. So we've been playing a lot of two-player games. Memoir 44 has been getting a lot of play in our house lately. I don't really know what brought this on. She kind of has a vibe for like the historical stuff. So we've been playing a lot of Memoir. And then from there, Starship Samurai gets a lot of play in the apartment as well. That's one of our new releases. It has giant mechs, you know, these big plastic miniatures. They're pretty cool. So we've definitely been enjoying that one. And then a lot of Unearth, which is her favorite game. I don't know if you guys have seen that one before, but it's like a dice placement game. It's very, very cool.
Yeah, it's on my short list. The wife and I, every time we're in my Barnes & Noble is what I always reference. Every time we're in there, it's just sitting there looking at me in the eyes.
I was actually surprised. Like I played it a couple times with 3 and 4 players, and I really enjoyed it. I kind of get anxiety in games where you have like a row of cards and everybody's kind of working towards them. Like Something like Splendor or Century, which are both amazing games. I'm not here to say otherwise. It's just like personally for me, I get very anxious because I start planning to get this one card and then somebody swoops in and buys it. And I'm just like, okay, my plan fell apart. I don't know what to do. But Unearth is really cool because the dice add a level of mitigation there where you can't plan on what a die is going to roll. You can only do your best to kind of assess how many sides it has and you know, hope it's in the right range. So that adds a really interesting element to the game. And I was actually really surprised with how good it was at two players.
Nice.
So I have to ask, okay, you said you moved in with your long-time girlfriend, and the first game you mentioned is Memoir 44. It doesn't sound like she was a gamer before that much. How did Memoir 44 become the game you play together?
I don't know if she's going to listen to this, but I'm just going to kind of give the inside scoop. I don't know what's going on with her. Like we've known each other for like 3 years, and I think the heaviest game she ever played was Dead of Winter. And the whole time she was like, well, this is kind of confusing. I'm not really sure what's going on. But it's very like Dead of Winter is a great game like that because it's very thematic, even though there's a lot of mechanics going on. Something about, I guess we moved in and then there's just like this giant stack of board games because I have my collection in the apartment. And now she's just like ravenous. Like I cannot bring home enough games for her to play. Tuesday night, which we're recording on right now, is our weekly game night here at the studio. And she showed up and learned A Feast for Odin, which like I was looking at it and I was like, this is too complex for me. And she's like, oh, this game's awesome. I want to play it at my bachelorette party is what she said. So I wish I could explain, like, it's for some reason, she's just really into board games now.
Awesome. And hey, okay, so Starship Samurai, the newest release from Plaid Hat, if I'm correct, right?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay, so tell me a little bit about this game, because I've seen it. I've seen a couple reviews for it, but it's not a game that I, you know, for lack of time and number of games I have to play, not one I've jumped into very deeply. Sell me on Starship Samurai.
I honestly think the game might have been born out of the name itself. Like, I feel like it maybe came to Isaac Vega in like a dream or some kind of fugue state because he started with this awesome name that just grabs your attention and kind of worked backwards from there. The best way I can describe it is there's a level of area control. You basically have these big tiles in play, and there's a number of tiles equal to the number of players, and each tile has seven spaces on it, and then a very large area where you put a tarot card sized location card, and these locations all have different effects and different rewards, and you get those rewards if you have the most ships there. So naturally that leads to players trying to move their fleets to control these areas. You have all these fighters and these carrier ships, very like, you know, what's that show? It's like Starship Yamamoto or something like that. It's definitely like that style with a big long spaceships. Everything has kind of like a futuristic, like feudal Japan vibe to it. And then on top of all that, every player has these two giant starship mechs, which are these like, you know, Gundam size, very stylized characters with these awesome weapons and, you know, these really neat, unique abilities. And so you're throwing your army all around the map, trying to get the benefits of each of these locations. And then at the end of each round, there's one final battle for every location. And whoever scores that location is going to get, you know, X number of victory points. And you play over a series of rounds, and then whoever has scored the most location has most locations and has the most points at the end will be the victor.
Nice. Awesome. All right. So Josh, as always, it was your birthday.
Uh-huh. Oh, happy belated birthday, man.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that.
So, I mean, it's not always your birthday, but as always, you know, when you have special events, I'm sure you set aside much time to play board games. So what did you get through this weekend?
Well, I got yelled at from my wife because I kept buying stuff. That's for one. I had a few days off before my birthday, so I went to Target and I picked up Ticket to Ride New York.
Right on.
As soon as it dropped. I'm on the Dice Tower Facebook group, so I always see people posting. And, of course, they're like, you have to ask for it. And, of course, I had to ask for it. So it was not out. And I had the worst time finding Choose Your Own Adventure House of Danger at Target because I went to three Targets and they all told me they didn't have it in stock. And then they all brought me to an empty end cap, which showed me where it would have been, which is not helpful to me at all. But they did that. So I saw people having issues on the thing too. I also was DMing with Target because they saw my tweet and tried to fix the problem. And I was like, don't worry about it. I saw everyone else had the same problem. So I just ordered it online for pickup and you guys had it in 20 minutes for me. So
were you standing in the store when you did that?
No, I was, oh, that would have been so- I, I was so disappointed that I left. So I, you know, and then I, it was later on the next day that I did it, because I've been waiting for this game for, since it was announced, like 8 months ago, 6 months ago. So I've been very excited to get it. So I'm just actually talking about what I got at this point. we pre-ordered T-Dragon Society for my wife. So we grabbed that as well. And then today my copy of Role Player and Wasteland Express Delivery Service arrived. So that's my, all my birthday gifts to myself. And then my mother-in-law got me Ticket to Ride Rails and Sails. She actually bought it when it was still being printed. I think it's out of print now, which means I probably shouldn't have opened the wrapping and just sold it. But I really want to play it. I'm a big Ticket to Ride fan. So I have all those to play. We did play some games. I do want to mention, I'm going to talk about Choose Your Own Adventure, but we played Century Golem Edition. On my birthday, I introduced my mother to the game, and my buddy who typically plays games with us, he hadn't played it either, but I had never played it four player. It's always been two player because, like Callin, it's my wife and I, we, it's two player games now. Before we had a kid, it was 4 to 6 to 7 player games and it was awesome. And I love my kid, but since the kid, it's two player games. That's it.
But is he not playing Century yet?
Not yet. We'll get him there. It's easy to teach. So the second he can comprehend, we worked on 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 today. So we're almost there.
Pretty much. That's all you need.
Yeah, he could say one. That's about it.
I think you could play like the game then, right? He's got numbers down.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm still waiting on the mind to ship. I pre-ordered it 2 months ago and cool.
Are you going to be getting the Target version of that as well?
Yeah, I saw that they, I almost bought the Target version of King Domino because it comes with the tower, the castle. But
yeah.
I saw the expansion coming out comes with the castle.
So oh, there you
need, go. So I don't need the Target version anymore.
Yeah, but my friend tempting. Was showing me the new version of the mine with a different art for Target, and I think it looks really cool. Like I was already kind of on the fence about that game, and like I think I'm definitely gonna pick it up when it gets to that big box version.
Yeah, I'll have to. Maybe I'll grab it. I don't know. It seems like it's people love it or hate it, so I'll see where I fall on the
for sure
on the game. But yeah, Century Golem with four players is too long of a game. It takes way too long compared to playing it two player first. Because in two-player, you're constantly going, you know, and when someone thinks for a while on a card in the market, like, even in two-player, that's a long time to wait. So for four players, it just, everyone enjoyed it, but it was just, for me, very, very long. So I didn't, for me, it's going to stay probably a two-player game, unless I can introduce more people to it. But I think two-player game, that's a sweet spot.
I can see that for sure.
Yeah, it was just, it's a great game, but it was tough for players.
So I know you love that game. Has that changed your thoughts on the game overall at all?
No, I think it just makes me more critical of it because of how much I love it. So when I'm playing it, I was more concerned about people thinking it was too long, if that makes sense. I wanted everyone to love it. So I was just, I think, hypercritical about it. I still would play that. I'd play that with 10 people if I could. It probably would be a terrible game, but I would do it.
Are you pretty tied to the Golem edition, or do you have the other version as well?
I have Spice Road, and I picked up Eastern Wonders over the weekend too.
Excellent, right on.
Yeah, I mean the art and the production quality of Golem just blows away Spice Road. The gems alone make it a different game.
Oh, for sure. It was really interesting to see the two different versions. So those were developed before Plan B kind of came together. So back there are members of Plan B that used to be part of F2Z. So I got to see that pretty early on, back when it actually had a different name. It was going to be called Caravan instead of Century, but that was part of the deal that those games went with Plan B when they kind of started up their own studio. So it's been awesome to see like the whole life cycle of that game and how it got really strong critical praise once it came out. Emerson is a fantastic designer, and he's honestly one of the nicest people I've ever met.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's great. Great get for Plan B, like just to like launch on that essentially.
Yeah, definitely. They've had a bunch of games kind of in that vein of like, you know, 2-4, kind of puzzly, a little abstracted. Like I think that's a really cool market to you know, carve out for yourself. And you like, you really have to have super strong designs in order to make that work.
Yeah, and I mean the fact that even Eastern Wonders, one sheet of instructions.
Yeah,
mind-boggling how they can do that and make a game make sense. But it doesn't leave a lot of room for questions when you're playing. So that's a lot that's of fair. It's a lot of BGG looking up, making sure you do things right. So House of Danger, Choose Your Own Adventure. If you have read a Choose Your Own Adventure book, I don't know if kids nowadays do. I know Barnes & Noble carries them. It really is a choose your. So for the uninitiated, back in the day, in the 80s, in the 90s, you get these Choose Your Own Adventure books and you're reading a narrative story, but at the end of a certain amount of pages, when it would come to a natural break, you have decisions on what you should do, what you think as the reader you want to do next. And typically in the books, you get 2-3 decisions. And when you're a kid and you're reading them, you would always keep your thumb on the page where you were, because you could always die where you were going. You didn't really know what was going to happen. The game is kind of like that too. They handle it a little differently. Your book is a deck of cards, and they're like the longer tarot card style designs. And you'll read, there's a front and a back to each card. Sometimes there's drawing, sometimes there's not. But essentially you're going to this house. I want to say it's the Marsden house. I could be confusing it with an actor, who knows. I'm not going to spoil any story, so I won't tell you why you're going or what you're doing. But so if you're playing two-player, the game can be, it's one or more players. So I can promise you the amount of people you add over one is the amount of difficulty it will be to play this game. Because okay, you have to be of one mind to successfully navigate this game. So I played with my wife. There'd be a lot of times where I'd ask her, what did she want to do? If we wanted to do the same thing, perfect, we'll go do that. There was a lot of times where she didn't want to do what I wanted to do. And we might, let's say we might backtrack a couple times, or we might die in the same spot a couple of times. It's very frustrating. I enjoyed it. It's fun. And we finished chapter one. There's 5 chapters in the game.
Oh, cool.
So it kind of does have, it's kind of like escape games where, or like legacy games where they're, the, you know, replayability can suffer, but I could see you playing it with other people and kind of just being a guide and taking them through the story. What you do is you'll read the card. It'll tell you 2 options, typically make a decision. Then you give the card it's telling you to read to the person to your left. So everyone basically gets to narrate a little bit of the story. You have items, you find items while you play, like you have strength bonuses, dexterity bonuses, observation, perception, these different types of, and I think agility. So all these things come into part on optional or mandatory challenges in the game. And you can use, if you have like a weapon and it is a fighting challenge, you can use your weapon and it will give you a bonus. The game, you use 1 6-sided die. If you roll a 1, it's considered a critical failure. You automatically lose what you're trying to do. And if you're using a item to boost, you automatically lose that item if you roll a 1.
Oh, wow.
And it's only a 6-sided die. So it's not so like...
It's coming up a lot more than you want.
Yeah, it's very challenging. We definitely rolled a couple of 1s for sure. And we definitely ended up in, we'll just say, a shallow grave a couple times in the same exact spot. But some weird stuff happens. I definitely found myself laughing out loud at how ridiculous the story is at some points. But all in all, it's very fun. And for $25, it's a steal. The production value is very good. So it gets a big recommendation from me.
Right on. This is in my employee store cart right now from Z-Man. I'm really excited to pick it up.
Nice.
I love the aesthetic of it. Like, it looks like a worn out book.
Yeah, it's great. And I will say this, like, they don't have like a great save feature. Like you have this track you're moving up, psychic track.
Okay.
You have a danger track. The higher your psychic track is, essentially the higher level you are and the more observant we'll say you are, or the more bonuses come to you. And the danger track essentially tells you what you need to roll to success. And like it starts at 3, goes up to 6, and you have to roll above that number to pass. And when you complete chapter 1, they're like, if you're not going to keep playing, take a picture of where you stopped.
Oh, that's weird.
I'm like, maybe I'll get a notepad.
So how much is this a game versus how much does it feel like an activity?
It's definitely, it's less of a game than you would think. Okay, so let's compare it to a Plaid Hat game since we can do that while we're here. You take Stuffed Fables, okay? A lot of Stuffed Fables is narrative storytelling, but not a lot in percentage of gameplay. So you might do book like story one or even page one, and I think it's 50-50, maybe even 30% narrative and 70% gameplay. For House of Danger, it's like 20 gameplay, 80 gotcha. Story. And it can get frustrating because you end up reading some of the same cards again. So you're faced with the decision to reread the card or just skip to the decision part on the back of the card. And I found myself, like, my wife wanted to read the card, and I kind of got frustrated, not at her, but because, like, we don't need to be reading this again. It hasn't been that long of a time where I forgot what's going on. But with the more people you add, I think you might have to continue doing that.
Yeah.
Which would make the game longer.
Gotcha.
Interesting.
We also ran into a point where we could have ended the story, and there's a like a clue deck, and it was, like, full. So, you know, we decided to keep exploring. They let you continue to explore. And that ended up resulting in a lot more death and a lot less item getting. So you don't really know what's in. Sometimes in the clue deck is diversions. Place like there's a maze in the game. It might just be a turn in the maze. And sometimes it's a clue. And sometimes it's a bad thing. So, like, if you're a completionist, you have that OCD, it can be tough.
Gotcha.
I know it sounds like I'm saying a lot of bad things about the game, but overall, it's very good, and I can't wait to continue playing through it.
Awesome.
And I'll probably gift it once we're finished with Chapter 5. I'll probably gift it to somebody who I know is like plays two-player or solo games.
If only there was someone you podcasted with who did that.
Yeah.
Well, man.
If only.
If only. Any other games you've been playing, sir?
Yeah, but we go on and on forever.
Okay.
But T-Dragon Society, check it out. It's a $20 game. The art is great. I posted a bunch of pictures on Instagram. I'll talk about it next week probably. And Ticket to Ride, it's insane. It's a gateway game. It's it plays in 10 to 15 minutes. It's insane.
Wow.
And if you know Ticket to Ride, it plays in 10 minutes flat.
Okay. It's
a very, very small map. And they added a couple different things for bonus points, but you're done in 10 minutes.
Okay. And
that's great. I mean, that's great to get people into Ticket to Ride, but Ticket to Ride is a gateway game. So you're doing a lot of legwork to get someone into board games with Ticket to Ride New York.
Maybe it's meant to be a filler.
It's definitely, you know what? I'll play it after Gloomhaven. That'll be
there. You go. That's a good palate
cleanser. It's like a gate handle game.
Yeah. There you go.
Awesome. All right. Well, there's two things I'm going to talk about. One I've talked about before, but I want to give a brief update on. So the significant other, the wife and I, are still working our way through Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective. And let me tell you, talking about a game that is much more of an activity, this is 100% fits that. It's really good. But if you ever want to feel really dumb, I'm telling you, this is the game to play. It does not make you feel smart at all. Like, even when you get the stuff, you don't feel that smart because at the end you read how fast Sherlock Holmes did it and you're like, oh, all right, well, that's great. You know, I took 3 times as many moves as he did to figure this out. Perfect. I've talked about it on the podcast before, so I just want to bring it up again, not to go in depth with it, but just say we're still working our way through that. And it is really excellent. If you are looking for a good story, they're really well written. The descriptions are well written. When you go out and you're investigating the different areas, all the conversations you have with different suspects and the other people in the games are really well done. It just is definitely one of those games that if you are not in a thinking mood or if you can't pay attention the entire time, it can definitely be challenging. And just similar to the whole choose your own adventure games, it can be very challenging because in this last scenario that we did, my wife wanted to go one direction and I wanted to go one direction. So like for multiple turns, we each spent just kind of investigating our own thing. And then both of them were not probably the direction we should have been going. So then our score got really bad because we had followed all these leads we didn't need to, but it's still really good. So if you are into that mind teaser type of game, and if you're really looking for a solid narrative game, I definitely still recommend Sherlock Holmes. Multiple expansions that are available for it, so I really still definitely recommend it.
This one's on my shelf. I just haven't taken the dive to learn at all and get it. Like every time I take all the books out and I lay it all, I open up the map, and then I'm like, maybe not tonight. Maybe a different night.
Well, that's the thing about it, that it's so surprisingly easy to learn because
I've heard like rule wise, it's actually very thin. It's just a matter of going through all this data. And like, I love the theme so much. My girlfriend's really excited to play it too. She's actually a private investigator. So like, I'm going to destroy this game. Perfect. Like, I don't know if all those skills transfer. You can't Google anything in this game. So we'll see.
Yeah, no, I do remember when I was learning it, read through the rule book and I was like, that can't be it. It's literally read the story, decide where you want to go. And that's all you do. And then you go to that place, you read the passage for there. And then it's the next person's turn to decide where they want to go. And that's all you do.
Have you heard of a game called Beyond Baker Street?
I have heard of it, yes.
So it's a really cool game. It kind of plays like Canopy in that it's a co-op and your hand is faced away from you, so you can't see the cards in your hand. But each card is like a value and also a suit, and the suits have to deal with like different clues that you're trying to, you know, use to solve this murder or solve this crime. And the theme is kind of similar to Baker Street in that you're trying to work against Sherlock. So every time you do an action, Sherlock advances one space, and so you're trying to complete the crime before he does. So it's very satisfying when you beat him in that game. So maybe if you guys are having a tough time in Consulting Detective, you can bust that out.
We'll have to go that direction. We have played a ton of Hanabi to the point that we don't even have to. Yeah, the nonverbal cues that we give each other, I feel like are cheating at this point. But hey,
you got to be careful with those. Well, it definitely might want to check out then if you guys enjoyed Hanabi, because it has a lot of variable powers and you're definitely. Yeah, there's a couple more things to consider in Hanabi, and you have like a clear end goal, which is something I really prefer versus Hanabi. Like, I don't like, you know, oh, we have a score of this. Like, this one is like, did we solve the crime or not? So that's a lot of fun.
Added to the list.
It's pretty good.
Excellent. So the other game that I want to talk about, though, is a game that I have mentioned before on this podcast, but never talked about in depth. But since Callin was here and Callin did a podcast about this game, I figure it's time that we talk about it a little bit, and that is Ashes, Rise of the Phoenix Born, a game from Plaid Hat, just so happens, that is a customizable card game. As I have someone who played a ton of Magic, and that's kind of how I got into the board game realm, and Magic got really expensive, so I was constantly in that pursuit of another type of card game that could fit that need, that competitive itch that I have when it comes to games, but wouldn't cost me quite as much money. And wouldn't be, you know, me spending hundreds of dollars to put the decks together that I want to. Ashes is kind of straightforward in the sense that you have a deck of cards that you can, if you want to, go through the whole deck building process of creating your own deck if you want, or handily enough, it comes with some suggested decks for you to get started with. The one really cool thing I like it is that it has the starting five mechanic where you get to pick the first five cards that you're going to have in your hand, which is a really cool idea in the sense of developing and building your strategy. You don't have to worry about the idea of, you know, have I put enough lands in my deck like I would with Magic or something like that. Like, you really get to kind of craft the idea that you want how you want to play the game and your strategy for approaching it. But then instead of having lands or anything like that you tap for or use for resources, you have dice. And I love rolling dice, even though I'm really bad at it, which seems statistically impossible, but I'm really bad at it.
I talked to Will Wheaton about that. I know, right?
So, but yeah, so then you are rolling dice and then you are using these to play out the cards that are in your hand. I think another thing that I really like about Ashes, maybe compared to a lot of other games, is how much incremental interaction there is in the game. That, you know, you have your initial step of getting up to your five cards and start and doing your roll and starting the game, but then it's very quickly back and forth. You take a main action and a side action if you want to, and then it goes to the other player, and you just do that back and forth with really small incremental games of playing creatures, creating a spell book that's in front of you. So like if you use a spell, it doesn't automatically disappear like it often would in Magic. and just really being able to craft this board and this position that you want to, and then having the different Phoenixborn, who, if you played Magic, is kind of like a combination of the player and a Planeswalker smashed together. And it just is a really cool, in-depth game that I think is, if you're looking for a competitive game that lets you put a lot of personality into your decks, definitely makes you think. And I think it's something that there's not, I mean, I'm not up on the competitive scene. I just play it with my wife. But I think it's definitely a game where you can't necessarily know exactly what's going to happen next. In Magic, you had a very clear delineation of, like, this person's playing this deck. Here are the things I need to watch out for. I'm sure in competitive Ashes that probably happens, but in friendly local games with my wife, that doesn't happen as much. So obviously, like I said, Colin, this was a game you had a podcast about. What about Ashes do you enjoy so darn much?
Yes, many moons ago, I used to do a Ashes podcast that I miss very much. I love this game. It hit me like a ton of bricks. I played Magic, you know, for most of my life. I still have a couple decks knocking around. I got very much into the Fantasy Flight games, living card games. I, you know, like you, I was very attracted to the model of, like, you know, I don't want everybody to have to buy all these cards just to get their deck. Like, it's much cooler to me that we can just have this giant, you know, palette to paint from and kind of customize our deck there. But even, you know, the living card games have a lot of cards going around. So it became, you know, a little bit of a chore to convince people, like, hey, this is a great game. All I need you to do is buy 3 core sets in every single expansion, and then we'll have a great experience together. I'm not trying to speak ill of living card games. I love them to death. But I found Ashes, and something about it just, it reminded me a lot of Magic. It had that awesome fantasy theme, but it was still vibrant and interesting, and, like, the art style was so unique, and it really grabbed my attention. And so I started to explore the mechanics more, and I just found a game that I really enjoyed. The dice play, one of my favorite things when I first discovered the game was the integrated round structure, like you were saying, Kyle. The ability that you only do one action, and then someone else does another action, and then you only do one action. Like, it made games feel so tight and exciting, and it wasn't just like, I'm gonna do everything on my turn and then I'll throw it to you and you'll do everything on your turn. It was just a really cool system that I hadn't really experienced before, and, like, I think that a lot of games have kind of, you know, taken that idea of integrated turns in a big way. Like, I see a lot of very similar things in Star Wars Destiny and Legend of the Five Rings, so it's certainly something that's coming up in the industry in a big way. And like you said, the dice were just really cool, like this idea that you had this in Magic, a lot of the time you're ramping up mana, whereas in Ashes, you start the round with 10 mana, basically, and then you go down from there. So the idea of, like, really having to, like, manage your resources, manage the cards in your hand, manage your life, manage your board state, manage the dice and when you spend them and what you spend them on, it was just intoxicating. I loved that game so much when I first played it, and I still love it a lot. I play it as much as I can, but it's work now.
So, if you're interested in any of those styles of game, I can't recommend Ashes enough. And if nothing else, it is really pretty to look at. The art in that game is spectacular.
Yeah, a lot of the art was done by an artist named Fernanda Suarez. She also did Dead of Winter, so if you're a fan of that game, you might see something kind of similar. She's since departed the team, but we've got a couple different artists that have kind of picked up the slack for her. I'm very excited about the next 2 decks that we have coming out. It's the first time we're using a new artist named Thanderlyn. And these 2 decks have kind of like a werewolf vampire kind of vibe for one of them. And then the other one very much has like a light and darkness kind of like divine, you know, spiritual kind of vibe to it. And then we've announced 2 more decks past that. So those decks are called the Spirits of Memoria and the, oh my goodness, I'm totally blanking on the second one. The Demons of Darmus. Sorry. Whew, that's my job. What was going on there? So those are going to be coming out in just a few weeks, and we're actually going to have copies available at Gen Con this year. Mm-hmm. And then later on, in I believe November, we're going to have 2 more decks, and those, that the one is called the King of Titans and the other is called the Ghost Guardians. And those decks introduce a brand new mechanic to the game that I think people are going to be really excited about, which are called mounts. Which are basically like, you can take an ally that you control in the game and remove them and instead replace it with, you know, an ally riding some kind of like, you know, spectral horse or a giant dinosaur or something. So it adds a new element to how conjurations and allies interact, and it kind of strengthens allies because you want to be able to put out these awesome, you know, creatures that they're able to ride around the battlefield on. So I'm really excited to see how those shake up the game.
Awesome. Very cool. Well, hey, you know, we've talked a lot about tabletop, but we also play some video games on this podcast. So, Callin, have there been any video games you've been playing lately?
Heck yeah. Actually, the game that I played most recently is not a new game at all. So Switches have been just, you know, spreading throughout the office. I think that Isaac got one first, and then Colby, our studio manager, picked one up shortly after, and then Jerry did, and then we have a graphic designer named Kendall. She bought a Switch, and then I was the last person to get one. So at this point, most of the studio has a Switch. And because of that, Jerry Hawthorne, he's the designer of Mice and Mystics and Stuff Fables. His son loves Skyrim, and they ended up with two copies of it. So last week at work one day, he was just like, hey, I have a free copy of Skyrim for Switch. So if you want to take it, it's yours. So I was like, all right, cool. So I've been kicking around Skyrim a little bit. I love my Switch so much. I've been playing that. I've been playing a lot of Hollow Knight, which came out on the Switch recently. I think it was on PC originally. I'm not sure if it was on PS4 as well, but it's a Metroidvania game with this really awesome art style. You basically play like a ghost bug in this like haunted city that's kind of filled with bugs, but they're all being kind of like driven crazy. I don't know, the story is pretty wild, but the art style is really, really engaging and really fun and very unique. So I've been playing a lot of that as well. And then what else on the Switch? The Switch pretty much dominates my gameplay time now. I'm really bad at downloading like every indie that comes across on it and filling up my hard drive on it. So I think before that I was playing a lot of the Shovel Knight collection. So yes. I definitely have too many platformers and too many Metroidvanias on my Switch at this point. So I should probably start, you know, shaking it up, but that's pretty much what I've been playing.
Did you play Celeste on the Switch?
I haven't. I'm a little too afraid that it'll be too hard.
It's very hard.
Yeah, so Celeste is kind of the same issue I have with like getting Dark Souls on the Switch. I'm just really afraid to get something that's so frustrating on a console that's very easy to throw across the room. So I'm kind of worried about, you know, going too deep. That being said, Hollow Knight is super hard at parts. I'm really enjoying that one, but it's definitely kicking my butt.
I think if you can handle Hollow Knight, you can definitely handle Celeste. And Celeste has a really nice assist mode built into it where you could like turn on double jump and turn on slowdown and turn on extra life and turn on all of these things so that if you ever get frustrated in a section, you can just give yourself a little boost to get through it and then put it back to how it's quote unquote supposed to be. So Celeste is great. I would definitely recommend it.
I think the problem is I don't know if I can handle Hollow Knight yet. I guess time will tell on that one. I got the Mega Man collection number one for Switch because Mega Man 2 is one of my all-time favorite games. And man, speaking of assist mode, that one just has the straight up like you can rewind time as much as you want, and ooh, that is very convenient, but boy does it become a crutch at certain parts.
That's awesome. That would be very convenient. I had a problem with Sonic Mania on the Switch. I used to be good at games and I'm not now, or what's the deal? Why is this so difficult now?
Those older ones are tough. Like I had, even with the assist and the time warp, whatever it's called, like I couldn't get all the way through Mega Man 1. I had to like set that aside and come back to it. Like I knew I could beat 2 because I've beaten 2 before and I enjoy it so much. But even 3 I'm having a hard time with because I can't slide under Proto Man all the time. It's tough.
Awesome. Hey, Josh, what have you been playing on your television?
Oh, boy. Well, you know what? I did watch that Uncharted fan film twice already. I'll say
it's
that.
So good.
It's pretty fun.
My dad sent me an email, which he never does. And he's like, did you see that Nathan Fillion Uncharted movie yet? I'm like, he's like,
yeah. Aren't as good. Like, no offense to either of those actors, but it's just like, it looks like Nathan like jumped out of the game with him, whereas those two were just kind of like very serviceable actors. So it was almost like highlighted how much they weren't as similar to the games.
Yeah, they could have got the girl who plays Elena. She's identical to her character. Mm. Spot on. And they could have got her. I feel like she's still a current TV actress. So maybe she didn't want to do it. Maybe she's done with Uncharted.
My friend was like, oh, Nathan Fillion's too old. They should have done this like 5 years ago. And I'm like, dude, like, have you played Uncharted 4? Like, that's when the story's interesting to me. Like, yeah. I don't need to see young people jumping around anymore. Like, it's an inherently more interesting story to me when it's an old guy. Like, that's why I'm excited for this new Spider-Man movie, the Into the Spider-Verse. Like, I want to see Spider-Man in sweatpants and kind of over this whole job and just kind of like lethargic and like, I've been doing this for 10 years. That's way more interesting to me.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I can't wait to see it in theaters. I thought it was just going to come straight to video. But I think we referenced Kyle referenced in the beginning, this isn't a movie podcast, so sorry, Kyle. So I continue my frustration with not being good at Fortnite. I'm still playing Fortnite. I jumped in just to see what season 5 is all about. I still enjoy it. I'm aging out of it. But I jumped into PUBG, and man alive is that game tough after playing Fortnite. Like, PUBG is snail shooter.
Brutal.
Oh man. And I'm playing on Xbox One X, and that drop into Miramar was horrible. I drop in still. That game need to fix that. They wonder why they're getting killed, and you can't on an Xbox One X, you can't jump into the Miramar map without landing in a building as it appears on you.
I used to play it on PC, and like I remember at the time there was an issue with like data leak, which is like basically the game would say you need, like, I had 18 gigs of RAM and it was saying that I didn't have enough, which I'm like, that's not accurate for that game, right? Like the game would start basically loading over itself and it kept saying that you didn't have enough storage space and it would crash. So it's definitely frustrating. I wish there was just a more optimized version of it, you know? Like, I'd rather wait a little bit and play like a final product than have everything be early access.
Yep. No, and I think that's what the biggest complaints they're getting. I mean, the PC people don't seem to be having a problem, so.
Yeah, that was early on, but it's just like, it's just weird that that's the product out there, is like this thing that isn't quite finished, but is so successful that it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it really is bizarre. And they're bundling it with Xbox consoles, which is insane. So I played some Bastion just because I love that game, and I just kind of jumped in. I've been playing NHL 18, which is crazy for me to play a sports game in general because I typically don't. But with NHL, like, it's really fun to play drop-in games because you're controlling one character. You're controlling your guy for the whole game. So it's not like Madden when you try to play like co-op, you're not involved at every play. But like, if I'm the right wing, I'm the right wing the whole game. So that's, I got a cool job to do on the, I have to either defend my side of the ice or attack the other side, and it's nonstop. And if you commit a penalty, you sit that penalty out. You're sitting in the penalty box watching people play. So you're motivated to not commit penalties. It's totally different than playing, like, my first like four games, I kept hitting the B button to swap characters. And I'm like, no, that's just a cross check. I'm me. I can't switch characters.
And you're suddenly in the penalty box a whole lot.
Yeah, I'm in the penalty box. But I tell you what, when you're involved with a one timer or a wrist shot and you get that goal, you feel like you gave your team the winning edge. And it's awesome. I love it. And I'm playing it on EA Access, which is great because it's free. Well, not free. It's $30 a year, but. And they're adding Dante's Inferno tomorrow to back compat. I'm going to start playing that again because I love that game on the 360.
Oh man, that game.
But speaking about old game being old, I started back up. All right. So I tried the Octopath Traveler demo. I'm still looking for an RPG for me, and I haven't found one that clicked. And I had a real problem with Octopath Traveler just with the time it takes in between conversations with people. Like, and I think that's a unique to me problem. I've talked to people about it. People think I'm crazy or I'm experiencing slowdown. So I'm going to try the demo again. But to either like hit A and fast forward through the conversation. Yeah, I do that. And then there's about 13 seconds between text bubbles. No wonder the game is 80 hours. Your characters take 13 minutes to get through a paragraph. So I'll give it another shot. I'm also not a big fan. I love that they did voice overs, but I'm not a big fan of them repeating the same words in conversations with the same character. So it's,
yeah,
like,
that's tough.
Hello, my whatever. And then he says it like 8 more times in the same paragraph, but he's not saying that sentence anymore. These are minor gripes. I'm happy that everyone's loving the game, and maybe I'll give it another shot and love it, but I just, I'm like, hey, I'm in EA Access looking around. I never finished Dragon Age Inquisition, so let's boot that up. You know, let's install it, let's play it. And I'll tell you what, that game ages real well. It looks beautiful. and the combat is great. I don't know why Mass Effect Andromeda couldn't handle the Frostbite engine, because Dragon Age killed it. It's so good. So I'm just loving, I'm loving it so far. I don't have too much to talk about. I'll say a gripe of mine, something that my like OCD, or maybe I'm anal about it, but I don't like that I have the option to change characters. I like to just be my character. I feel like it gives me too many choices, and that's my problem with, I like linear RPGs, and they're very few and far between.
That's probably why you like Horizon so much.
Yeah, I love it. Horizon is a perfect example of a game that feels bigger than it is, and you can do stuff, but if you want to stay on the straight and narrow, same reason why I love the Uncharted series. These are games that feel huge that are not as big as they appear. So that's my cup of tea, I guess. So I like that I can issue commands in Dragon Age. Like I can hit select and bring up the combat zone and issue commands, but I just issue one command at the beginning of combat, and then I never touch them again. So it's really wasted on me. but there's a lot of options, and I love it so far. And I'm sure I'll love it, because I played all the other Dragon Age games, and the lore is fantastic. They do a great job of, even right at the beginning, they're hinting at Morrigan and all these stories from the past. And if you play the other games, you know that. And if you don't, it just still is a great story. And you're like, oh, who's this woman they're talking about? So it's great. Go play it if you have EA access, or if you've never played it. It's also like $10 used at GameStop. So maybe spend $10 and play an awesome RPG.
And basically anytime there's a sale on any store, whether it be PS4 or Xbox, that game is on sale for like dirt cheap. So
yeah, pretty much.
Awesome. Well, hey, I will go through very quickly what I've been playing. I finally finished Bulletstorm that I started forever ago. I forgot how big the cliffhanger ending is in that game. Like, they clearly made that game with the intent of making a second and or third game, and we very clearly have not gotten the second game.
You finished Bulletstorm?
I did finish Bulletstorm, yeah.
You didn't mean to say Far Cry 5?
I didn't mean to say Far Cry 5. I finished a game that's far more fun than Far Cry 5.
Man.
I will get back to Far Cry 5, though, I promise. I will finish it before the end of the year, so I cannot put it on my top 5 games of the year list.
Well, Mars drops tomorrow for Far Cry 5.
The new DLC.
You all can go play on Mars. That's fine. But I did finish Bulletstorm. And like I said, if you like stupid, dumb, fun games, it still is a stupid, dumb, fun game. I did then boot up, as I had said previously, Resident Evil 4, because I didn't have a GameCube. I didn't ever play Resident Evil 4. I got it on sale one time, super, super cheap. So I booted it up on the old PS4. That game is old.
Oh no! It doesn't age.
No, I mean it ages not bad as far as visually, because it's like, you know, it's a remake. But the controls in that game, oof.
Man, yeah, you missed out. I played that on the Wii, and that was the first game I ever did 24 hours straight playing a game.
Oh really?
I love that game so much.
Oh, I mean, I'll keep playing it. It very obviously is kind of like not quite fully tank controls, but kind of tank controls. And I was hoping that, you know, with this more modern version of it, that wouldn't be true, but it still is very much true. And that's a little odd. And also, it doesn't tell you very well what you're supposed to do, which is okay. Like, that's not a bad thing. But I got to like the first little town you get to, and there's all these people that are trying to kill me, and I'm don't know really what to do. So literally all I did was just run around a lot. And there's a guy with a chainsaw who cut my head off. Uh-huh. And then I'm like, well, that's clearly not the right answer. So then I ran around again. And then eventually they all just went to church, and I got to continue the story.
He's
good. That's all I did. I didn't kill anyone. I just ran around for like 5 minutes, and then they all went into the church.
You gotta kill them. You're not gonna get a weird achievement because it's Resident Evil. They're all bad. Kill them all.
Oh, I know, but I'm also keep in mind I played like the original Resident Evil, so like I'm thinking I have to conserve all my ammunition, and like I can't just go shooting things. So I just ran around for a while, and then they all left, and that was great.
Yeah, okay. I definitely don't think that game is for everybody. I think if you're really gonna enjoy Resident Evil 4, you need to ask yourself a couple questions. Mainly, what are you buying and what are you selling?
There you go.
Have you not gotten that far yet?
No.
Oh, no. Okay. That was a bad joke.
I'm literally like an hour in. I'm not very far at all.
There's like this merchant that like for some reason shows up in every town, even though there's all these evil monsters everywhere. And that's like how he approaches you. He's like, hey, what are you selling?
Oh, okay. Yes. I did. I got to the merchant the first time. Yes.
He's wearing
okay.
like a full cloak and has a backpack. Yeah, yeah. And you're like, there's like people turning into zombies and monsters everywhere. And he's just like, I'm just hanging out in my cloak. What's up?
Slings well, some watches from the inside of his jacket.
So I will keep playing it because so many people love it. It's just not, yeah, I'm sure it'll be great. It just getting used to those controls again is going to take a little bit of time.
I can see that not aging super well. Have you played Resident Evil Revelations at all?
I have not.
So 1 and 2 are on the Switch and they're pretty cheap. They're definitely inspired by Resident Evil 4, but they play a little bit faster. I'm not a huge fan of the series or anything. It's just like I picked these up kind of on a whim. They're very fun shooters that you can play in little increments. In fact, like the game is actually structured as like if you beat a section of it and then you like turn your console off, when you come back, it'll be like previously on Resident Evil and it'll give you like as though you're watching a TV show, like that little bitty like catch up moment where like it has clips from everything that happened. So it's very interesting, but it might be like a more modern take on what Resident Evil 4 was trying to do.
Gotcha. I played the first 3 and then I just haven't played anything since. And I have 7, but I haven't played it yet. So I was like, well, I feel like I should play 4, 5, and 6 before I jump into 7 so I can understand why this change they did in 7 was so revolutionary. So
well, it's not to understand the story because I have no idea. I've played so many of these games and like every time a new character pops up, they're like, oh, I remember you. And I'm like, well, let me hit the wiki because I don't like.
So another game I've been playing that is drastically different than Resident Evil is I've been playing Captain Toad Treasure Tracker on my Switch. And let me just tell you, I really like this game. Captain Toad is wonderful. If you're not familiar, it's a puzzle game that each level or each board, even if it's actually, it's probably because I like board games so much, but each board is basically a diorama that you have to get to the star in the level and collect the star and that's it. And that's pretty much what the game is. But just like any other puzzle style game, or like if you've played the Hitman Go or the Lara Croft Go games at all, you know, there are other challenges of picking up diamonds or getting a certain number of coins, or there's other challenges that you need to complete to fully complete the level. There's, I think, 82 or 83 boards total
awesome.
In this game. They divvy it up into like chapter stories. So I'm through the first story. I'm in the second story. And I think I've done probably 25 or 26 of the boards so far. But I'm really enjoying it. I think it's, you know, it's a $40 price point, which is, I think, maybe a little high for some people still. I think just getting through and getting to the stars themselves hasn't been challenging at all yet, but definitely completing all of the tasks they want you to fully complete a board. Some of them have perplexed me a little bit. So it kind of depends on how you want to play it. But overall, really nice game, especially on the Switch to pick up. Play for 5 minutes to finish a level, then you can set it down and go do whatever else you need to do. So
hey, definitely. $40 for first party is awesome on the Switch too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I know it's a port, but I've had my eye on this one because like you said, I love anything that feels like a board game, especially mm-hmm. like portable like that. So I didn't realize they were going to be releasing it for $40. So I might buy that on the drive home.
Yeah, no, it's definitely worth it. And, you know, one of the games that I've played this year that I really enjoyed was Moss on PSVR. And mm-hmm. this has a lot of the similar feelings that Moss did, is that you kind of enter this thing. Granted, it's not in VR, but you just enter this area and you're like, all right, how do I solve this puzzle? Moving on to the next thing. And it's
kind of that isometric, like manipulating a 3D object vibe to it.
Absolutely. 100%.
Very cool.
It's a good demo for it, too. Yep. So you can always try that before you purchase anyone who for is Captain curious. Toad?
Yeah.
Excellent. I'm downloading that tonight. Excellent. Yeah. Cool.
All right. So, hey, that's what we've been playing. But, you know, and we've talked a long time, actually, about what we've been playing. But, hey, we're very fortunate to have Callin on today, as back on July 9th, Plaid Hat Games, well, now that I look at our show notes, I realize that this is no longer accurate, thanks to you guys in announcing new games all the time. But back on July 9th, you guys announced a new game called Guardians. And, hey, Callin, you're the designer of the game.
I sure am.
So, if you're on the video game side of our audience and maybe aren't super familiar with Plaid Hat Games, you've definitely heard us talk about them on the show before, because we've talked about a lot of the different games that they have, and they're some of our favorites, like Dead of Winter, Mice and Mystics, Stuffed Fables, Ashes, which we talked about a little bit ago, Summoner Wars, and a lot of others. So with that, we're going to just chat a bit about and get to know Callin a little bit better, learn more about Guardians, which you can pre-order now on Plaid Hat's website if you'd like to. But before we jump deep into Guardians, Callin, can you just provide us a bit about your background on you, and what was your journey, and how did you end up at Plaid Hat?
Yeah, sure thing. Like I said before, I started a podcast with my friends called The Main Action, a show about Ashes. We were just really enamored with Ash's Rise of the Phoenix Born, and we wanted to discuss it and grow a community for it. And I've been wanting to break into podcasting for a while now, so I decided we would start a show together. And we had a great time. We had a lot of fun doing it. We got to meet some really awesome people in the community. Through that, we found out that Plaid Hat Games is actually based in Dallas, Texas, which is where we were all living at the time. So I reached out to Plaid Hat and I was like, hey, you know, we love your game. We saw that you guys are local. You know, if you ever want to do anything, let us know. And Isaac Vega, the designer of Ashes and Dead of Winter, he is one of the nicest people I've ever met in my life. And he is so supportive of any type of art or any type of like creative endeavor. And he's always trying to like, you know, prop people up in the community in a big way. So when he found out that we were doing this podcast, I think it was like episode 5, he was like, hey, I want to be on it. I want to talk about Ashes with you guys. Let's do it. Come over to the studio. He invited us to the studio. We recorded an episode of the show. We made plans to do a couple more. He invited us to a party they were having like 2 weeks from there. He invited us to Ashes Weekend in Tulsa, Oklahoma with the Team Covenant guys. Just very, very supportive of the show. And that led to, you know, us spending a lot of time with Isaac in the studio. And that led to me, of course, wanting to volunteer with Plaid Hat because I love the studio so much. And our back catalog is just full of some of my all-time favorite games. Like I will widely say that Summoner Wars is probably as close to a perfect design, in my opinion, as you can get. At least for what I was looking for at the time. So that led to me spending a lot of time at the studio, you know, doing a lot of demoing, doing a lot of playtesting. From there, there was a opening for the communications manager position, and Isaac thought that I would be a good fit for it. So he put me up and I interviewed for it with F2Z at the time. They thought that I was a good fit as well. So I got the position in 2016. And from there, I've just been, you know, working on our social media, and I've helped, you know, work on some playtesting and development for some of our games. I've worked with Isaac very closely on a lot of his projects, and everybody else in the studio as well, Jerry and Colby. And yeah, that in a weird way led to me getting to make my own game. I somehow tricked Colby into letting me release a game. So
what you're saying is if we start a Guardians podcast, we can get a job at Plaid Hat.
I'm 100% saying that. Yes, that is the everybody I know. I'm like, start a podcast. You might get a job. Like my friends are really excited about a game coming out called Artifact from Valve. And I was like, is it Valve? Yeah, it's Valve. And I was like, yeah, dude, start a podcast. What's the worst thing that can happen?
Awesome. So, hey, was this a career path you always wanted to go down? Did you always want to work in games? And how did you or when did you first know you wanted to design a game?
The first instance I knew I wanted to create some sort of game was probably, I would say, in eighth grade. I used to play a lot of Dungeons and Dragons, and I was always the dungeon master. I never had any interest in being a player at all. I always wanted to create the world. I always wanted to create the story. And I did a session once with a couple of my friends, and we just spent all day playing D&D. And I think that was the moment I knew, like, I wanted to create something that other people would enjoy. And I don't think I knew at the time that it was going to be, you know, board games, because I hadn't really discovered the hobby yet. But I've always had a big passion for, you know, creating my own content to kind of add to things, especially Dungeons and Dragons, any other role-playing game. I used to always want to, you know, homebrew and tweak the rules and add my own supplements. So that was the first time I really like wanted to create something. You know, fast forward to me kind of getting involved with the hobby, design. Anybody who works in games will tell you that everybody has an idea for the game, right? Like, and that's I don't think that's a negative thing at all. I'm not trying to say that to like discourage anyone. Like, I think it's so cool that there's something analog and tangible about board games that maybe not so much with video games, but you can see yourself making and creating something there. And it's so easy for anybody to grab, you know, scissors, markers, and some paper and just start cranking out cards for a game they want to create. So it's very open. There's not as big of a barrier of like learning to, you know, code or use any type of programming software as you would for a video game or something like that. So board games are very unique in that aspect.
So nice. Were board games, like, did you always want to work in the industry? Like, how did you get to, was it like, hey, I'm doing this other thing, but Plaid Hat came a column, so sure, I'll sidestep into this? Or
I never thought I'd be lucky enough to like get to do this full time, and like it still feels like a dream, and it's very surreal. But no, I certainly wasn't like putting my resume out there to like studios and stuff. It was very much kind of a right place, right time thing for me. And you know, I think that I was passionate about Plaid Hat because, you know, they were local and I was able to, like, I love their games and I was able to show them off to people, but I never imagined it would turn into a career path. So it was, I'm very lucky, and it's very, very fun. And, you know, it's cool to be able to work on something you're so passionate about and translate that into doing something full time. But yeah, I would have definitely taken a different path in college if I thought that I was going to be working in the industry full time. If anybody's out there and they are very passionate about board games and they're younger and not sure where they want to kind of step their foot into, there's a lot of like game design courses that are coming out right now, but honestly, I think like one of the most consistent ways to find work in this industry is to become a very solid graphic designer. That's something that I tend to notice. Everybody always needs a good graphic designer, and you probably have way more consistency and security if that's where you're looking at.
Yeah, definitely super sought after people, and you can tell by how much work you see in all these different games.
Of course.
Yeah. All right. So, If you're listening, you can check out the rule book for Guardians on Plaid Hat Games right now, which is what I did. So it's going to lead to my question, because I think I have a guess, some guesses, but I'm going to ask for you, what were your inspirations for Guardians? Now, having that said, I think you saw a post originally, someone was like, it's like the Overwatch of board games. And I'm pretty sure they just based that decision off of the character design. So what say you, what were your inspirations for the game?
Yeah, let's go ahead and address the 800 pound gorilla with a jetpack in the room, right? That's kind of a deep cut, but yeah, I love Overwatch. It is one of my all-time favorite games. I love so much about that game. I think that it is an absolutely amazing video game, and there is no hiding at all that Overwatch was a huge inspiration for Guardians for me. Originally, and it was kind of a running joke with a lot of my friends. So there's a mechanic in Guardians. It's very similar to a game called Smash Up, where you take several decks and you shuffle them together. And I think AEG, the company that makes Smash Up, was the first one to coin the term shuffle building. I've always loved that mechanic, and like I was first exposed to it by Smash Up, but it wasn't until I played a living card game from Fantasy Flight, the Star Wars living card game. That was the first time I started thinking of shuffle building as a very strategic element to a game. So I would say for about 2.5 to 3 years, I was trying to make a card game that had shuffle building as the main element, and I just couldn't land the details of it. I couldn't get it to work the way I wanted it to. And it became a running joke with my friends that I was like, hey, I have an idea for a game. And they'd be like, let me guess, it's shuffle building and you pick three characters, right? So that was definitely like a concept I was locked into. Early iterations of this game, it was actually kind of themed around MOBAs. So stuff like, you know, Heroes of the Storm or League of Legends, because like that already has that element of, you know, crafting your team and how it affects things. I actually started working on what eventually became Guardians before, I know nobody's going to believe this, I guarantee. I actually started working on it before I was exposed to Overwatch. I was aware of, you know, the game's existence because it was so popular, but I was trying to make this MOBA game work, and I messaged my friend Kian, who is actually a member of the Main Action podcast back in the day. I messaged him and I was like, hey, you play a lot of Overwatch, right? And he was like, yeah, I love that game. And I was like, so in Overwatch, is it just like whoever gets the most kills wins? And he was like, oh, no, it's all objective based. And I was like, oh, interesting. Like, tell me about like how the objectives work. And he described the payloads. So the idea of like the more people you have on this payload, the faster it will move. But if at least one person is stopping it, then the payload, or if at least one enemy is near it, the payload stops cold, right? And so the idea of like you have to get it from point A to point B. And something about the way he described that just really, it clicked with me. And like I started seeing a visual representation of how that would work in a card game. And that led to the locations in Guardians. In Guardians, there are four locations in play at all times. And each of them has a token in the middle. And it kind of works like a tug of war. Like you're trying to get it to your side of the field while your opponent is trying to get it to their side of the field. And the way you do that is by standing on it, kind of like an Overwatch. Or if you knock out enemy heroes at that location, you'll get to move it a little bit further. So once that concept kind of solidified in my head, I was like, man, that you know, I really think there's a card game here. I should really develop this. So I started working on all these like crazy characters. I've always wanted to make my own like pantheon of superheroes. It's been a dream of mine like since I was very young. So I started working on all these different characters and giving them different abilities in the game. And at one point I was talking to my friend Christian and I was like, hey, I have this idea for a character in the game. He's basically going to be a robot and like he'll have two different modes. And like in one of them, he can't move, but he can attack. But in the other one, he's very mobile, but he's not as strong. Like, do you think that's cool? And he was like, dude, you need to buy Overwatch. Like, it's possible. And so I was like, all right, fair enough. So I bought Overwatch. I played a ton of it. And I wanted to definitely kind of mimic that style and definitely the style of like the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So like very futuristic, not as much like tights and capes and stuff, but still feeling like these bigger, like these larger than life characters with these like, you know, very futuristic abilities. And that was definitely a huge inspiration for the game. So if you're a fan of Overwatch, I think that you might find something that you really enjoy in this world for sure.
Nice. And I will say, the first thing, so if you're a fan of Smash Up, this is what I liked about it right away. It was familiar enough with knowing Smash Up. The mechanic was familiar enough for me to get it right away, but it's so much different than Smash Up that I feel like it's its own unique thing. Like, I feel like it must get frustrating to hear people compare your game to games so often, and that's just a guess. I feel like I would be. But I think in board games, it's always important to like find a common ground for someone, especially like how people like to use like gateway games as examples. Like if you liked Ticket to Ride, you'll like this game. Like I feel like when I was reading the instructions, I was like, okay, I got that part. And then right away you're introduced to the push and pull aspects of the game, which immediately threw me for a loop. So I'm like, okay, good. This is totally different and unique, but familiar enough where I can grab like, this will be good for my wife and I. Like right away, I knew this would be a game that we would like. So I was happy to like read that. I don't know if I'm like rambling.
No, not at all. I completely like art is very iterative to me. So I'm not shying away from this game being similar to Smash Up at all. In the same way that I'm not going to shy away from, you know, my huge love affair with Overwatch. Like it's one of my all time favorite video games, and I still play it to this day. I'm super hyped for the hamster coming out soon. Like I really enjoy that game a lot. Smash Up, I loved what Smash Up was doing, and I think I've talked before about how Smash Up has this really instantaneous gratification when you create something at the table. You're like, and there's never going to be a combination that you play in Smash Up that hasn't been played before, right? Unless you are the designer of the game and you just came up with a new faction. But when you sit down, you're like, I made zombie dinosaurs or I made ghost pirates. Like you put ownership on that. And right away, I was very intrigued by that. Like that's why I like shuffle building so much, is because it's just the same way you build a magic deck where you're like, you know, somebody can have the exact same magic deck, but you're like, that's my deck. I picked the sleeves for it. I picked the mana. I picked the art. This is something that I've created. And like gamers love that. They love having that ownership. And I think that shuffle building is a really cool way to give you that ownership without having to have you pick 30 or 60 cards, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. All right. So I think you touched on this a little bit. But so for people like specifically me, but other people like me who are super clueless on how designing a game, like even begins, like from go. So like, not to put you on the spot, obviously not, but like, what's the design process? What was your design process? And how did you go from like imagination to physical objects?
It's a lot. So I'd love to give some tips that I've learned, because I'm still kind of exploring this aspect. That like, my job is not board game designer. My job is totally, you know, communications and customer service for Plaid Hat. This is something that I've gotten to explore, you know, working here at the studio. I work with three of the greatest board game designers of all time: Isaac Vega, Colby Dauk, and Jerry Hawthorne. Those guys are on my Mount Rushmore of board game designers, for sure. Like, so I've learned so much of their process, and like I try to imitate it as much as I can. the first thing that I would say is, like, play as many board games as you can, especially stuff that interests you. Like, if you, you know, for example, if you love Magic the Gathering, then go out there and, like, buy a starter for Force of Will or Pokemon or, you know, Card Fight Vanguard, like all these other dueling card games. Go buy a Destiny starter. Expose yourself to things that you enjoy in different iterations, and don't get caught, like, definitely don't get caught up on one game. You know, if you love Magic, don't make Magic 2. Nobody wants to, you know, really publish that. It'd be a tough market, you know? But, you know, if you love worker placement, play a lot of worker placement. Find things that you enjoy and, you know, grow your back catalog of knowledge, because you're never going to be an expert on something unless you and I don't claim to be an expert, but you're never going to be, you know, competent in something unless you expose yourself to as much as possible. From there, I would say, personally, this is how I approach Guardians. Like, make the game that you would want to play. Like, I wanted a shuffle building game that was a little bit deeper than Smash Up, but you maybe not as overwhelming as Star Wars. And, like, I wanted it to have, you know, this pick three and, like, you know, have a hero shooter vibe to it. So, like, that's what I kind of honed in on it. And it took me a long time to get that game together, but that was definitely the process that I went for it. From there, and this is probably the biggest hurdle that a lot of people run into, but there's a term in board game design called rapid prototyping. And I learned that from listening to a YouTube channel that I think it was called 1000 XP. There's a guy named Chris Rowland that used to do a series on there called Board Game Design Time. And that was a huge tool for me to, like, learn how quickly you should be getting an idea you have to the table to test it. And, like, it's not going to be a great experience right away, but nobody makes a finished game in their first, you know, pass. Right. So it's important to, you know, get a computer, hop into Word. I don't recommend Word, but hop into Word or hop into InDesign or hop into Google Docs and start creating stuff as soon as possible, because that's when you're going to start getting stuff on the table and you're going to start iterating and finding what works and what doesn't. And that's when you're going to find, you know, the design that's inside of you that you want to, you know, bring to life.
Nice. I love it. So you hinted on a little bit earlier. So how much has Guardians changed from the beginning? So, like, how similar or different is it from finished product?
So if I'm talking about shuffle building pick three heroes game, which has always been floating in my mind for, like, the last 2 or 3 years, it's definitely changed a lot. It's you know, the theme has changed, but that's not really important. The whole mechanic of, you know, having locations and battling over them, that was all that's all been ripped apart and put back together. The game as it stands in its current iteration actually didn't change too much. Initially it was four heroes instead of three. But we found that was just kind of overwhelming. The biggest changes from, like, early iterations of the game were that you basically had you would have an ability card, and, like, there's all sorts of, like, random systems that I just kind of ditched. Like, you know, heroes would have, like, ultimate modes where they would flip over and have, like, superpower versions of themselves. They would also be able to attack other heroes at different locations, whereas now we've streamlined it to where you can only attack heroes at the same location. You know, all sorts of weird little mechanic things like that. Like, there's a currency in the game called charge, which you gain from playing different cards, and it lets you charge up your ultimate, which, like, again, anybody who's played Overwatch knows that's kind of like that meter in the middle of your screen. We used to have charge be, like, a much different currency, and you spent it on all sorts of different things. But that's all stuff that, you know, as you go through iterative designs, you find what works and what doesn't. And, you know, play 3 or 4 games, see if this mechanic works, you know, look at the implications of cutting it. Will it change the you know, the core conceits of the game too much? If not, maybe try without it. A lot of the cool changes that we implemented in Guardians didn't come around until Colby, the studio manager, kind of put his hands on it. He's an amazing developer. He is very good at knowing what to cut, what to keep, what to zoom in on, and what to kind of, you know, let fade to the background as far as game design goes. It's always really awesome to get, you know, an accomplished developer and designer to put their eyes on it and kind of, you know, put their own spin on it. And they might, you know, get rid of things that are kind of, you know, near and dear to you at first. But when you play a version that, you know, lost that mechanic or added this one, you might find that you're dealing with a much better game. So that was definitely what happened for me with Colby. Like, he was able to turn this into a very streamlined and very interesting and dynamic game.
Nice. You know, I did want to mention, I really love, it's, I don't think that you see this too often in games, but just looking in the manual, the fact that you have two separate sections for 2-player and 4-player is a huge help for people like me who, like, I struggle finding games that have solo that are clear with instructions, and there's not a lot of games that will specifically teach out a two-player game and a four-player game. You're pretty much learning
the two to four,
So I think it's, I love that that's in the book, and that was refreshing to see, I'll say.
Just yeah, right on. Well, I mean, it's a team variant of the game, so it was very important that we split it up and make it very clear that, like, it's not just playing with more players. Like, it is a different experience, like, as a whole. It was actually kind of, you know, interesting when we first tried the four player rules. It was just kind of something we were knocking around in the office, and you know, the four player rules were almost like a first pass for me. I was like, I think this will work. I designed the game from the ground up to be a two player head to head card game because that's what I love. But then we played the four player and we were like, oh, this is actually pretty fun. So like, it was a tough choice to include it in the base game because it meant that we had to include a second side to the summary cards, and we were worried that that would get confusing. And then additionally, like, we had to include a whole nother set of basic cards for a third and fourth player because you need them in your deck. Yeah. So it was definitely, you know, something that we kind of went back and forth on whether or not we wanted to include it. But in the end, I'm glad we did, because it, one thing that I really like about Guardians, and this might just speak to, you know, how many card games I've played, and like I said before, like, trying to convince people to, you know, we'll have a great experience if you buy the base game and then two more copies of that and then the expansions. One cool thing about Guardians is that you draft off of a single set of the game. So as long as one player has a copy, you have the full experience. So, you know, it doesn't become a matter of I have to find a friend who will also buy in with me. You just need to be able to find a friend who wants to play with you, right. Which I think is a lot easier to do for head-to-head card games. So the same goes with the four-player game. We didn't want you to have two copies of the game just to play four players. So that's why we included those.
Nice.
So one of the things that I get confused about, because I'm not a super smart guy, is that obviously you're the designer, but there's a whole lot of other people who work on this game with you. One thing is, what is the difference between like design and then obviously like Colby's is listed as the producer, but like I know some places will call it like developer or development. Like, what's the difference between design and that side? And then also, how much control do you have when it comes to graphic design and art? Are you like, I want this person who's going to have these sweet Valkyrie wings who's going to fly, and then this person, like a Tracer, they kind of are an inspiration there. Like, how much control do you have like in those aspects when working on a game?
Well, I'll let you in on a little secret that I've been learning since I've been spending some time in the board game industry. I think that we are all making up terms as we go along and just kind of applying it to the... The best that I can surmise it is, to me, I think a designer is someone who comes up with the core concept of the game and probably the majority of the mechanics in the game. There is a weird thing about board game design, and that is it will always get better when you show it to someone else and get feedback. As you become a board game designer, you start to crave that feedback in a really weird way. Like, even if they just destroy your game, you're like, yes, tell me more. Tell me what I can fix. Tell me what I need to improve. So a developer to me is someone who kind of does that professionally. They have like I think a good strength of a developer is being able to find the fun in the design and being able to find the interesting design space and, you know, set up the rules so that you can explore that later on, creating interesting decisions for players. This is all stuff that the designer will probably do in their first, you know, pass, but a developer can kind of come in and, you know, collaborate with you and, you know, maybe let you see the problems with your design in a different angle, and maybe like kind of like Captain Toad, like, you know, rotate that design around so you can see the star. But yeah, that's definitely what I consider a developer to be. Colby is also listed as a producer in the game because he is the manager of the studio. So he's listed as a producer on the majority of our projects, if he's not also the developer or co-designer. And that just has to do with his role as, you know, the studio manager. As far as art direction, man, I have a really hard time coming up with characters, in that I will come up with the mechanics of the character, and then when I have to describe him, inevitably it's like, oh, he's got like futuristic armor and a mask and a gun. I don't know. Like, if I didn't have a good, you know, art director, then all my guys would probably look like multiplayer skins from like Titanfall or something, just like a bunch of guns and weird, you know, face plates or whatever. But we have an on-staff art director named Sam Vega, who's Isaac's brother, actually. And these characters, like, I came up with like the very core concept of them, and he was definitely responsible for visually fleshing them out. So in a lot of ways, like, I feel like these characters are just as much his as they are mine. Like, I came up with a lot of details for them, but he's able to visually expand upon the premise that I have for a character so much. So, you know, Whiplash is, you know, the one that kind of looks like Tracer, if we're going to be honest. Like, you know, I always imagined her as like, okay, I assume she has like some kind of gun that shoots like a cord, almost like Spider-Man, that lets you like throw people around and stuff. And that's like mechanically what she does, right? So when you see the full art of the game, he's the one who gave her the white hair. He came up with, you know, having those kind of goggles. She has these, if you look at her hips, it's almost like Attack on Titan-esque like gear on her hips that lets her, you know, fly around in the art and do all sorts of cool tricks and stuff. That was totally like an inspiration from him. Like, he came up with that idea. So Sam helps out so much with how these characters come together and how, you know, he relays so much to the artist, and he's the one-on-one point of contact with the artist. And like together they come up with these really interesting takes on the character. As far as you mentioned graphic design, we have two in-house graphic designers. This project is actually going to be the first one for one of our graphic designers. Her name is Kendall. She's a bit newer to the studio, and she's worked on a lot of projects up to this point, but this is the first one that she kind of took, you know, from the ground all the way up. This is all her design, and she was definitely like project lead on that. So I like to joke that Guardians is kind of like Plaid Hat, the next generation. Like, we're the two newest staff members, and we got to make this game together. So it was a lot of fun. But she worked, you know, our graphic designers work very close with the designers because they trust the designers to know what information needs to be, you know, gotten across to the players. But at the same time, like, they rely on their own skills and their own expertise to make sure that information is being displayed in the most visually pleasing way possible.
Awesome. Well, give big props, because I think the graphic design is awesome. So give
her
big props.
Yeah, she did amazing. And like, she was able to use the art that we got from Gunship and from the other artists that worked on it and really make it pop. And, you know, the cover is like actually not a commissioned piece. Like, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this because it makes it sound like, you know, we were saving money or something. But the cover was actually like, originally we were going to commission a cover, and we had all these different designs, and we had a couple different sketches that we were working from. At the time, you know, it's pretty close to, you know, Avengers Infinity War coming out. So we were starting to see a lot of posters for that. And then there's also a poster from Thor Ragnarok that has kind of a similar, you know, aesthetic to it. So if you guys look at the posters for, you know, Thor and for Infinity War, you can very much see that it's like a collage of heroes and all these dynamic poses that kind of like arcs up into a pyramid. And she was the one that had the idea of like, hey, I bet we could do something very similar to this that would, you know, definitely give it like this epic superhero vibe to it. Because like, as much as Overwatch is an inspiration, like, I've always said that I wanted my game to feel like that scene in Captain America Civil War where like all the heroes are running towards each other at the airport. Like, that was like my mission statement. So like, I love Marvel cinematic stuff a lot. And so she was really able to bring some strong elements in from that.
Awesome. That's awesome. Well, I think we're at the ultimate question, and it's probably an easy question. Who is Guardians for?
Oh, that's actually kind of a tough one, I think. I love dueling card games. I always have. I played Magic since I was young, like I said. I wanted to make a game that felt like a head-to-head dueling card game that gave you that tension and that back and forth and that push and pull, quite literally, you know, with some mechanics. But I wanted it to be something that you could lay on the table, build your deck right then in an instant, and be playing with your friend right away. And so that's definitely the design, you know, premise that I went for with Guardians. And I really hope that we were able to, you know, hone in on that and give people a tight head-to-head experience without, you know, having kind of like the barrier of entry of having to build an entire deck every time you want to play. Beyond that, thematically, I love hero shooters. I think Overwatch is an amazing game. So it was definitely an inspiration to have this huge cast of characters that all had their own unique and dynamic abilities and their own unique skill sets. And you're tasked with, you know, building your team comp basically in Guardians, to use some video game parlance. Like, you're tasked with finding the right combination of heroes that will synergize together and, you know, use their abilities to, you know, bring the heat to your opponent and kind of push them back and put them on the back foot.
So, big question. Well, first side question, who do you main in Overwatch?
Oh man, it's been too long. So I, because of how much I work on board games, it's hard to get enough time to play video games. So as a result, it's usually when I go back to Overwatch, it's very easy for me to fall into like Soldier 76 or D.Va or Risa because, you know, it's just point and click, right? Like just, you know, throw as much lead as you can. So those are the heroes that I've probably played the most of. And then also like Bastion, because it's just it's easy to get, you know, play the game when you're just mowing people down. Right.
Right. Absolutely. Awesome. I'm a support main. So, you know, I always got to know who I'm healing. Next question then, and I'm throwing this as a curveball to you a little bit, so I hope this is okay. And you've been more than generous with your time tonight, so thank you so much for sure. That. This is your first board game design.
Yes.
How does it feel now to have it like out there? Like obviously people haven't really played it yet, but people know it exists. Like you can pre-order it. How is that feeling for you now? Is it relief? Is it more stress now? Like what is that all like for you?
I definitely think it's more stress right now because before it was like my secret little baby that no one knew about. And like I showed it to some of my friends and we had play testers and we talked about it in the office. But now it's like out in the wild. And like, I see all these like board game news outlets kind of reporting on it and talking about it and saying like, this is going to be at Gen Con. This is available for pre-order now. And then even people that I know in the industry that like, you know, create content, like, you know, my friends at Epic Game Night or Chris Bryan from Bored with Life, he mentioned it one of his news videos, and that was just like, wow, like I've never made something that was, you know, getting so much attention. So I think maybe more stress. And then like there's also like a weird element of just like, you know, we all know what the internet is, so like there's definitely some parts for people that are just like, oh, this is too much like Overwatch, or you know, oh, I don't like that, you know, this game has three decks instead of four, like all the weird stuff you hear. But honestly, like I'm very excited to see what people think about it. I'm so hopeful that this will find the audience that I wanted to make it for, which is me. So, you know, as long as I like it, I guess, you know, whatever, nerds, like I got to make it. No, I'm really excited. And like like you said, people haven't had a chance to play it a lot yet, but we did make the rules available pretty early on. That's just kind of how the studio works. We usually like to put our rulebooks up right away. And I've been getting a little bit of feedback on that of like, hey, I've, you know, seen the rules and I think it's a cool system. So like, I'm very, very hopeful. And I'm so excited for people to finally get their hands on it.
Awesome. And our final question then, is there anything else you'd like to talk about in regards to Plaid Hat, Guardians, or, you know, that whole Neon Gods thing you guys just announced?
Yes, July is a weird month for us. I think every single Monday in July, we have a major announcement. And if you're paying attention, we have two more Mondays left. we announced Guardians July 9th. It is available for pre-order now. It's the game that we were just talking about, head-to-head dueling card game. Definitely check it out. Very handsome designer. So after that, we just announced Neon Gods, which in many ways is actually kind of a re-implementation of an older game we have called City of Remnants. Neon Gods has kind of like, the theme is kind of hard to describe. It's like retro futurism. Like it's like what the distant future would look like if you were in the 80s. I saw some people calling it cyberpunk earlier. I think it's kind of more like cyber funk, if that's a term. It's lots of robots and like kitschy 80s references. Mechanically though, it's an area control game where you are spreading your gang out on this board and, you know, recruiting new members to join your gang. And, you know, you're fighting other gang members and you're trying to produce, you know, chems to sell for a profit or weapons, or you're building buildings on the map. There are cybernetic cops patrolling the streets. They're called Andes, which is short for Android. That you have to sometimes fight. So, you know, sometimes the cops will come and raid your spot and you have to push them back. So it's definitely like a head-to-head cool game. Anybody who is a fan of like some of the older mechanics in City Remnants are going to find a lot that they enjoy about it. And the art style is just like out of this world, crazy and weird and dynamic. We're going to be at Gen Con this year. The plan right now is to have both Guardians and Neon Gods available for a preview sale. Both games are going to be coming out in October past that. We can't guarantee the preview sale. We're still working on getting some copies airshipped from China, so it just kind of depends. Either way, we'll definitely have demos. So if you're attending Gen Con this year and you want to play these games, be sure to stop by the booth. We'll be there answering questions and showing them off. And like I said, we have two more Mondays in July where we're going to have very big announcements. So, you know, if you're fans of some of our older games or some of the mechanics in our older games, you might be very excited for some of the stuff we're announcing this month.
Oh my gosh. I know you can't say anything, but if there's going to be a new Crossroads game, I'm going to be so stinking excited. I know you can't say anything.
I can't say, but we've got some really cool stuff coming out this month.
I, Are you guys going to be at PAX Unplugged? Do you know that this far in advance?
We will have a presence in PAX Unplugged as a component of Asmodee, which is our you know, corporate overlords at this point. Yeah. They do a great job of representing us at all their conventions. Additionally, I think that Colby and Jerry will be in attendance at PAX Unplugged. I can't guarantee that for sure. And I think Isaac's going to be attending just kind of like as an attendee and not necessarily for work, which I'm very jealous of. And I might try and sneak a ride with him, but we'll see. So we will definitely have some presence there and we'll definitely be, you know, showing off some of these new games that we're going to be announcing in the near future.
Well, I'll be there for sure. We're seeing, we're trying to get some badges and see if we can get Kyle. Cause I'm going as a fan. We went last year with my wife and I, so I'll be there. If I don't have to work, that's even better. I'll just be there as me. But
well, excellent. Maybe we'll be able to get a game of Guardians in.
Yeah, that would be awesome for sure. For sure. Okay. So we don't have any email questions.
Well, it's because I knew this was going to go super long, so I didn't ask for any. Okay.
I will say this. Paul Calico, the winner of our Dice Tower Awards prediction contest, he has a job that I think is identical to mine, so he doesn't have time to listen to podcasts anymore. So he hadn't listened to the podcast. So he got my email saying he won, and he hadn't known. So he got back to me. So Paul got to get, well, Paul decided he wants Magic Maze. He didn't let me pick for him, so I'll be sending him Magic Maze probably this weekend. So congratulations to Paul on that. And we'll do another contest soon, I'm sure. But moving on from that, I keep wanting to say Callin. I'm sorry. But
oh, it's Callin, all good. It's been Callin, my whole life. Don't worry.
Thank you so much, honestly, for coming on this week. It's a thrill.
Thanks for having me. This is awesome. I think you guys are doing a really interesting concept with your show. Like I love video games so much. I wish I could play them more. I love board games. We're all big video game fans here at the studio. So a show that's kind of melding the two is a very interesting concept, and I'm very excited to see where it goes.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. I can speak for Kyle. That means a lot to us. Yeah. this is something that Kyle and I, when we were in PSVG, we were the two big board game guys, and you know, it means a lot to us to first of all have the show, but to have someone on like you, like this is big for us. And I know this is your like everyday life, but this is big for us. So it's awesome to have you on, and we can't wait for more stuff from you. And you're obviously welcome to come back on whenever you want, whenever Plaid Hat has something big coming out.
Oh, thank you so much, man.
Or small, if you just want to be like a regular rotating third guest. why don't you tell everyone who's listening where they can find you and Plaid Hat on the internet?
You can find me on most social media outlets as Cardboard Callin, which is, you know, clever because it's my name, and cardboard because we do board games. But more importantly, you can find Plaid Hat Games online, plaidhatgames.com. Do not do phg.com. I think that takes you to the Pinnacle Health Group, which is in no way affiliated with us. They won't even play our games or return our emails. So definitely do plaidhatgames.com. We're also on Twitter at Plaid Hat Games. We're on Instagram at the Notorious PHG, which is probably the nerdiest thing I've ever had to put into a computer. But we love posting, you know, little teasers and tidbits and surprises on our social media. So, you know, if you follow us on Twitter, you probably get a sneak peek now and again on something we're working on. If you follow us on Instagram, our studio manager Colby is kind of a live wire on both of those, and he will just spoil like major things. Like I think it was last week he just put up four pieces of art on Instagram from games that we haven't even announced yet, so they're just like out there floating, and he's like, yeah, speculate away, have fun. So definitely follow us on social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and yeah, if you ever, you know, see us at a convention, be sure to stop by the booth and play our newest games and say hi, because we love hearing from fans.
Awesome. Again, Callin, thanks so much for joining us. We really, really appreciate it. Josh, what do you say we wrap this show up?
Oh, you know, I always have to look up when you say that because that's how unprepared I am. Thanks for joining us, everybody. We hit it at the top every time. If you don't know how to spell board yet, it's a B-O-A-R-D with V-G. That's at gmail.com. That's on Instagram. That's on Twitter. What am I forgetting? Facebook.
Yeah.
That's where this all started, I think. Facebook.com/BOARD with VG. You can find us there. I don't have anything huge to plug. Josh Bones on Instagram, on Twitter, Bologna Borbone on Instagram. I always forget that.
They crack me up every time.
That's a tough one.
Him. She's just unify them all as one. Why So Serious? That's Sirrius on Xbox and PS4. I will have to get you my Switch code. We can all be Switch buddies. We'll get that going. That's it for me. Kyle, plug away. Plug.
Awesome. Well, hey, you can find me pretty much everywhere at Psychocross, C-Y-C-O-C-R-O-S-S. That's on Twitter, Instagram, PlayStation Network, Xbox Live, and Board Game Geek, all at that. If you have suggestions for future topics, be sure to reach out to us on the social medias because we want to talk about what you want to hear about. And remember, everyone, whether it be board games or video games, never stop gaming.
This has been a production of the Play Some Video Games Podcast Network. Find more great content at PlaySomeVideoGames.com.